Okay, so from a lookup presentation, you realize that for Rift Valley, we actually tried it for 2 years. 09, which is our pilot, we have about 100 students or so, I think three teachers. And then 2011, we have the full scale. So there is actually a difference again between these two set of tests. 2009, okay, this whole activity was actually post-lecture activity, okay, as a part of a laundry session. Whereas after this whole cycle, so I asked myself, is it possible that the student can actually pick up the learning even before going through a lecture? Because after going through a lecture, you have pick up some particular skills or knowledge. So what happened is that 2010, we actually tried it as a pre-lecture activity. So this is a concept that most students, I would say almost 99% of them will have no idea what is a confirmation. So we actually did this whole activity, and but quite happily, okay, there was actually a lot of positive results as a result. So you can take a look at what is really the outcome. So this is actually based on the 2010 activity.
This is for Sec 4 students, eh?
This is for J1, or what we call the year 5 students and incubator program. So for pre-lecture activity, we expect the students to be able to pick up elements, okay, of the following. What is this talk? What do you mean by total momentum is constant, total change in momentum, okay, so on and so forth. So what happened is that using the simulations, they have a very daunting task, which is actually to fill up this table. Okay, but luckily, the affordance of ICT in this case is that I can actually do the condition, okay, at a very, very short amount of time. In fact, the data gathering will take them about 10 or 15 minutes or so. And in order to so-called cut down time, actually assign them different kind of data to collect. But of course, later on there was actually some so-called feedback that they would rather collect all the data themselves. Rather than I collect one set, and at the end of the day, we'll come together again and get the result as a whole. The table was actually structured in a way to bring out the points that highlighted in previous time. Okay, this was one of the hardest things to come up with. The rest are actually pretty standard. So like for example, why I want this to be here? Why must this be colored this way? Okay, then what's the purpose? So after they've completed the tables, okay, they are actually asked to now relook at the data they have collected and also got from the other teams. Okay, put together as a one single table, look at the specific columns, what do they understand? So I think one of the so-called success story, okay, I believe, is that as we were going around the groups, okay, to look at the discussion, you know, listen to the discussion, we realized that the students, okay, although they did not go through the whole lecture, they actually could pick up points. Like for example, when they collect a certain set of data, they realized how come this one is actually off the trend. Okay, it's a certain trend. That's why the table was constructed in that way, and a lot of them can actually. Because they click something wrong, some values wrong, or they copy the wrong values, then they realize that something doesn't work out. Because of that, what we can argue is that the student actually engaged in a kind of self-rationalization, and of course, through all these little mistakes and all these small discussion, there's a lot of teachable moments. And at the end of the day, okay, from the point of the teacher, when we do a summing up, we can actually bring this across so that the learning becomes more. The next slide is for Jimmy.
Okay, for my part, I'm doing on interpretation. I'm someone who believes that if you want to use ICT, I make sure that it adds values. So for the topic of gravitation, it's something that's very abstract. And usually, we don't conduct accurate experiments in labs trying to investigate the effect of gravitation. And the effect of gravitation is only significant when masses are huge enough, things like that. Since there's no experiment to be conducted, so I want to use simulations. Four main areas, these are the four main areas, so I have four simulations to illustrate, to address all these areas.
Okay,
okay, the first thing is about field strength and potential, something that students are always confused about. Field strength is a vector, potential is a scalar, and then the negative sign, what's the meaning of negative sign? So to them, it's like something that they memorize. They can memorize definition, regurgitate, but they don't understand anything. So in the simulations, there's a source map with test mass. So they can play around this thing, they move the test mass, you can see the arrow represents field strength. Okay, and then when you shift to the left, arrow goes to the right. Shift to the right, arrow goes to the left. And then there will be values for the G field strength. So when it's pointing to the right, it's a positive value. Okay, the left is a negative value. So to the questioning. The questioning requires them to deduce the meaning of negative sign. Even simple things like that. Then you realize, okay, it is negative when pointing to a certain direction. Okay, and then when you go to potential, they do the similar things, and then they find that, potential is always negative. Thinking, they begin to argue among themselves, why is that negative sign? What's the meaning behind? So this is one thing that we did. The other one is escape velocity. In a topic of escape velocity, a very commonly asked question would be, how much energy do I need to launch something from Earth to the Moon? Okay, and then, so the idea is that students always think that they just find the potential at the surface of Earth, find the potential at the surface of the Moon, and then subtract off, find the difference in potential energy required. Through this, I let them try out shifting these test mass again. The different arrow represents the forces by the two planets. And then as they shift around, the length of the arrow changes. Okay? So you can just stop any point and click play and see what happens to the test mass. And then just try out a different point. And then they realize, there's a point where the two arrows actually cancel each other. The test mass stays where it is.
You can have a reason when it's not balanced. Simulation
show that it's moving, yes. So when it's nearer to the Earth, it can play, it should move to Earth. Yeah, nearer to the Moon, it should move to the Moon. Then they're supposed to find that point. And then the question continues to ask them to think about what's the meaning of this point. What's happening there? And then question number 7 asks them, okay, if I want to launch something from Earth to the Moon, I only need to shift it. I only need to launch that thing to that point. To that point where the forces actually cancel. And ask them why. Why do you think? They actually try out, if I just shift a bit to the left of that point, it actually goes to the Moon on its own. Next one about Joe's theory of it. After teaching for 3 batches, the students can come up with the 3 conditions for Joe's theory, but they cannot visualize, especially for girls. They really cannot understand what even Joe's theory said. So the simulation helps them. Okay, they see the satellite, you can see the Earth, they see the satellite rotating, and then there's this point that's aligned to the satellite all the time as it rotates. But what I like about simulation is that besides showing what is Joule's theory, it's also showing what is not Joule's theory. There are a few modes, other mode number 6 in this simulation. You have to see what happens if the satellite is going like this. Okay, while the Earth rotates about this green axis. Okay, obviously, this is not a Joule's theory satellite. They ask them why. Okay, why is it not? Okay. And the last part is on capacitor log. In the past, we will give them a list of period rotation, radius of rotation, and then ask them to do some block plotting, and then finally, you realize that T squared proportional RQ. They have no concept about all these numbers. It doesn't mean anything to them. So the simulation allows them to. So I try to use the simulation to help them to visualize. Okay, what happens when the radius of orbit gets longer? The period actually gets longer. So they play with different planets and observe. I think the simple act of just observing the motion ingrained into their mind.
Now, to the findings, okay, I will go through this very quickly. We have a series of, I think, about 10 questions or so. Yeah, just highlight a few. And you don't really need to go into detail again what the numbers are. I think because we actually positioned this as a pre-lecture activity, so obviously we asked them this question, how much do you know about conservation of momentum? Most of them are give you So after the lesson, okay, and this, okay, quite a large number of them were able to tell us at least, okay, what they mean by conservation, or at least, okay, the idea. So that is something that we are actually happy about. And I can stress that this is actually not a formal research study. They're only doing this more like a principles to find out how can we actually do better in terms of using the methods for lessons. Do you enjoy using this kind of the methods for learning? Do you enjoy this kind of activity? So these are actually the two questions that we actually count out for the set of technicians. And the next set of slides is actually on the YJ finding. We have a slightly different approach, but the result is also pretty encouraging.
I forgot to mention that the fourth simulation was actually injected into the existing tutorial questions. I didn't want it to be something extra. So in the set of tutorial questions, we are already actually addressing different of this concept. So I just inject inside. So the student is supposed to go home. We don't have a laptop. Everybody get a laptop. Okay, with the software, go back. While they're doing tutorial, they try out the simulations. After they understand, go through the questions on their own. Okay, then they try the tutorial questions. They go on to Joe's Strange Satellite, okay, they try the simulations, they try the questions. So that there's seamless integration. In fact, I think the student quite like it. They like the visualization. And it meets their need. And in a sense, they're self-directed learning because they're learning on their own, at their own time, at their own pace. Yeah.
Okay,
Next
slide also we also have some quality questions. So these were some of the stuff that we actually managed to count up. Basically, there were quite a number of similar findings between RV and YJ. And because we are from for our particular topics, we're actually in the JC. So for those who have experienced JC physics, you know that it is extremely boring most of the time. Like gravitation, you can't see anything. Conservation of momentum, and except for maybe having two cars colliding or two cars colliding. Okay, otherwise you wouldn't see it. So basically, the students was pretty appreciative, okay, that they were given a chance, okay, to see the stuff, okay, in action. Okay, then, of course, everything is not so rosy as well. There are also other comments, like for example, the simulation doesn't look pretty, because it's just a box. If we have time, we'll show you the box. And some of them will also prefer, like I mentioned earlier on, okay, to be able to collect more data on their own, rather than getting the data from the other groups. So this is a finding from YJ, and you can see that there are actually some similarity. But of course, for them, they are actually also looking at visualization for presentation. And of course, they are also looking at self-directed learning, which is not what we're looking at, okay, for people that is data.